Kia ora katou katoa, kaumata tua te waka, kau manga tanui te manga, kau wairau te awa, haere mai. I cannot believe the diversity in this room, so I thought I'd add some, and depending on how many beers you had in the break, you may or may not have understood what I said. My Norwegian is terrible, so you're stuck with English. I travelled 25 hours to get here for 20 minutes. It'll be the best 20 minutes of my week. Thank you to Neptune as well for having me here. I promise my agent will reduce the fee based on not getting the right Chuck Norris turning up to the program. All right, we're not here for stand-up. I'm not DevOps, I'm not IS, I'm not probably like a lot of you in the room, I'm definitely Ops, I'm in the business, I'm an end user. I'll give you some numbers in a second. You might wonder who the hell Fonterra is for a start and what the hell's New Zealand got to do on the global stage. But I can tell you, we do quite a bit. So I'm going to talk to you about an important part of my world, and that's Fonterra. So, you know, we've got 51 manufacturing sites across the world. That little dot down on the right-hand side of the map there, it's usually the one that's missed off most of the world maps. That's little New Zealand. I've got 30 manufacturing sites with a grand total of about 99 functional plants. We're the fifth largest dairy company in the world. We're the largest dairy exporter in the world. We basically feed forward to China. And as you can see there, Nestle at the top, B2B, we provide a hell of a lot of dairy nutrition to Nestle from the bottom of the world. We've got about 10,500 farmer shareholders, so we are a cooperative by a business model. And what we do for our farmer base in New Zealand. We're dairy for life at the top, bit of a cheesy saying, but all in all, the strategy is that we're a nutrition company and we're thinking about joint ventures with protein and printed protein. We're not just sitting waiting for the Kodak moment when all of a sudden people move away from dairy or, you know, we're into the future of nutrition. In New Zealand, we talk about milk pools in dairy, pools like swimming pools. So in New Zealand, we have about a 17 billion litre pool, and that's growing at about 1 to 2% per annum. Unfortunately, the markets we play in is about 60 billion litres, and that's growing at 5 to 6% growth. So in order to maintain your market share in dairy, you have to continue to grow your volume, otherwise someone will take you out on the way through. We export, 98% of what we make in New Zealand. There's only 5 million people in New Zealand, and we've got an awful lot of cows. We can't consume all of that dairy product, hence we're the largest export dairy company in the world. The why for me is I love what we do on the global stage, and it's all about sustainably feeding the future of this earth. And that's what I love about being dairy. We're pretty isolated, so the picture at the bottom left there, the tank is out on the farm. We've got maintenance workforces out on those 10,000 farms looking after assets. And then the other picture next to that, the monumental manufacturing facilities. One of our facilities, for example, at the peak of the season, you will see 450 full rail cars exit the back of that site every week full of food. I was a bit naive when I got into dairy. I thought it was a couple of cows, a few cans of milk, a bit of cheese. When you see 8 tons of mozzarella coming out the back of one plant and you've got a hell of a lot of them, you start to realise how much we consume. So I want to talk to you about, as we heard before, a process-driven, I guess, transformation. So core process is really important. And I hope, particularly for the partners in the room, and maybe even for Neptune, that from an ops perspective, this provides you an articulation of how to put your business case together as we see so many SAP plant maintenance environments ripe for the picking in terms of the use of Neptune software. So I'll talk to you from an ops perspective. Okay, I've made it I've made it really simple and really complicated on the same slide. So if you don't know anything about maintenance on the left-hand side, the black boxes, that's all you need to know. We find it, we plan it, we fix it. That's usually HR, marketing, that's what they think we do in maintenance. Okay. If you think you're savvy and you want to have a conversation with someone about it, it's the white boxes down the middle, and that's your core process. If you're starting to get really good, the blue boxes are where the cash flows in that process and maintenance. And then the green boxes are all the tactical enablers you have to have around this process to make it work. So in terms of core process and being disciplined in process, you can't deploy apps on that without fundamentally having a process in the first place. Moving to the right-hand side, there's a journey as well. So I pay annually typically about $70 million in labour costs, just labour costs alone, and a total of about $225 million in total direct R&M. And on top of that, there'll be probably another $150 million in capital investment to continue to maintain what just turned yesterday a $15.6 billion asset base. And that's just those plants in New Zealand, not the rest of the world. So when you look at the right-hand side, there's a natural journey. At the top of it, you'll see we started off, we went from 30% efficiency. So when I'm paying $70 million for labour, the big thing I want back as the general manager is a utilisation of that labour workforce. And that utilisation starts typically at around 25 to 30% for an immature organisation. And you can get so far by deploying process. So you can get to, we got to 38% by refining that process on the left-hand side. And that's just operating discipline, operating discipline, operating discipline and what you've got. The benchmark best practice is about 55% utilisation. So in an average technician's day, 55% of their day is on a spanner or a screwdriver, or they're actually adding value to the assets they're looking after. The rest of it's taken up meetings, managers, all those sort of good things. If you want to jump from the 38% to the 45%, you'll see there a little red box circled down on the right. That's about when you want to start deploying technology to enable that step change. If you deploy technology too early in a maintenance environment where you haven't got a reasonably disciplined process, you're really just putting lipstick on a pig. It's not going to work out for you, right? So make sure that your organisations you're dealing with have a pretty good core process in place and there's a level of operating discipline. I'm pretty happy with where we are. We're 38% and growing, and we were back at the 20% to 30%. And you really got to measure that quantitatively. How you measure that, there's various ways. So you can walk through the job, you can do job shadowing. The one circled is the one we did, which is the technician shadowing. So across those 30 plants, in one particular week, we conducted five shadowing activities of technicians and what they actually did in that day to work out what was going on for those technicians. So what are the frustrations, the impediments, the good things, the bad things that they're confronted with. And ultimately on the left-hand side, what we want to achieve is an increase in the green zone. So that's the effective time with which the maintenance tech is actually adding value back to that asset. We want to reduce as much as possible, if not get rid of the orange. So that's the old lean concept, get rid of the wastes. And there are some things you're going to have to do in maintenance that are just generally pains in the ass. That's the maintenance of your SAP system, that's the documentation, that's the permitting, all the other things that go along with sometimes a relatively dangerous job. So we call that the blue zone, which is the incidental activity. So it has to happen, but you want to make it as efficient as you possibly can. So when you do that shadowing activity and you look across 5 times 30 sites and you get a good end outcome, you end up with the left-hand side of the chart. So quantitatively from a business case, how are you going to justify Neptune, or how are you going to justify your partner application into the business? At the top of the black bar is 100% of a useful technician's day, and it's broken down by the things that we see through that shadowing activity. You can see some examples highlighted there. So on an average day, 30 minutes spent confirming parts. That's pretty frustrating for the average technician. They just want to get in and apply their craft, go and fix some assets, get on with the work. At the bottom, 45 minutes of data entry of results of the task into SAP or online checks. So That administrative burden is necessary, so it's an incidental activity, but 45 minutes of an average technician's day for me paying the bills is a hell of a lot of opportunity to improve. So we did some rough calculations in the first, so top of the right-hand side now. You know, if we started off with, and this is just an example, it's not real numbers. If we started off with 38 technicians at a tool time at efficiency of 28%, and we took that efficiency to 100% efficiency, it would take it to 88 technicians. So then we dial it back from there, and that's the second row. We dial that 88 back, and we say, actually, we only want 45% efficiency. Therefore, the resulting workforce should be the number in the red box. So this calculation in the top right is the first top-down calculation to justify a Neptune implementation into the maintenance environment, and that starts to get senior executives excited. It's not what you want to go and talk to the maintenance department about, because it means things for them, unionised workforces, like reduced headcount, all of that sort of thing. So it's the executive business case. When we've done this, and just to give you a bit of a teaser at the end, we look at the resulting business case post the pilot. So in US dollars, we're talking about a realised value per technician. So I've got about 1,000 full-time employees and about another 3,000 contractors at any one time. Per year, we would see $2,300 per technician in rework time reduction, $3,100 in travel time, that's travelling to the store, getting the parts, moving back, changing jobs, moving around the plant, and then SAP admin time of $7,500. So $13,000 per technician per year after the pilot activity with our partner Zag in the Blue Works app, is the business case to justify the further rollout. So by the time you've done that top-down quantification, you've given the executives their slice of the pie, and then at the bottom right there, we're doing the pilot, we're proving the UAT, we're going through the testing phase, we generate the further ROI to win that implementation business case. So we had all of the requirements. I'm a bit late to the game, so we've already talked about remote workforces up in the top left-hand side. We've got all those people out on the farms treating the farm assets, looking after the farmers' assets. They're remote, so they need RFID tags. They've got remote hardware, Bluetooth, RFID. They're syncing back when they come back to a wireless environment, so we've done that. Putting into the manufacturing factories. So a lot of those are actually not covered by Wi-Fi. They're quite large, and there's a lot of stainless steel around, so they don't respond well to Wi-Fi signaling or Bluetooth. Potentially nested we could get away with over time, but certainly we wanted that environment covered as well. When we did the pilot, I did a control group top right-hand side. So that's a different site without the Blue Works product in it. And what it's showing there is that the red line is only slightly higher than the yellow line. So when I talked before about $70 million of labor, I want that red line to be significantly higher than last year's performance as I deploy. So that means I'm getting more work done, I'm getting more work orders returned by the technicians, and therefore we're adding more value to the assets on a daily basis. The controls at the top and the pilots at the bottom. You can see the delta between the control and the pilot. The amount of significant upshift in that rolling 12-week average in the bottom chart immediately started to unlock and justify the reason why the Blue Works product is right for us. And there were a couple other kickers. The big one for me as a manager is we're partway through the pilot and my project manager gives me an update and he said to me, Chuck, you'll never guess what's happened. We've started to do some backdoor reviews of who's logging on when and what they're doing as they log into the app. Turns out you've got an extremely unionized workforce of people that are educated for about 4 years in a trade certificate. They're constantly taught to ask why. And these people are typically quite difficult to deal with. Maintenance workforces are not the worst culture to try and lead, but they're one of the more difficult ones to lead. But we had our technicians logging into the app on a Sunday night on their own device at home, looking at what work in their own time, looking at what work they had coming up for the next day when they got to work. And in my world, that's unheard of. Getting an engaged workforce, it's unheard of, that's right. Getting an engaged workforce that we all know about the give the employee a phone, you'll have them connected as long as they're looking at the phone, the concept of the whole employee. They had their own phones, they loaded their app on their own phones, and they were checking it on a Sunday night. And that's just a phenomenal amount of change demonstration. So where we're connecting to the hearts and minds of the end users rather than just the process or the dollars or the outcome. So a really good indicator early on in the project that we were starting to see a demonstrated cultural shift, which for most engineering departments will be what they really want. They don't want another app to go around and collect master data to update their SAP system and make sure all of the I's are dotted and the T's are crossed. They actually want people to be invested in what they do in that quality of execution space. And that's what we started to see. I'm not a conversant Neptune person either. And so coming here has actually opened my eyes up to the potential of Planet 9. We're on Planet 8 at the moment. This is kind of what it looks like. It's no different. In fact, you can pull out your phone right now and go onto the iTunes store or the Apple, the Android Play store, and you can type in BlueWorks with an X, and you can download that application in a sandpit environment, and you can see how it functions. It's pretty cool. And what it does for me is it takes the administration, which is typically about 14% of an average technician's day. It takes that administration to the point of work, and we're now starting to think about, you know, the next steps for us are integrating with our other IoT elements within the business. So we've got spatial models in terms of federated models. We've got IoT dongles doing rotating asset condition monitoring. We've got other trials going on with other parts of industry 4.0. And really it's about now integrating all that together, giving the technician as much information real time or flat file or document management system at the point of work so that they're making less up, they're doing a better job, and their quality of execution is improving. BlueWorks had this list of, Zag, and I love their tagline actually. If you can't see it, it's at the bottom. I've started using this personally actually. Zag, let the others zig. And I think that's a real good one for me, right? And this is what Zag's brought to us. So that's their list of what they perceive their value proposition is as a partner for us. I've highlighted the ones in blue that I think are the real ones from an operational manager that really matter to me. A lot of them matter, but those ones in blue, we found it really simple to engage, and that's what I've heard today as well with the other customer cases. It's simple, it's quick, it's offline for us, and we have many environments across that $15.6 billion footprint that are offline. It's easy, so we're getting a lot of young millennials coming into the business that they don't want to log into SAP, and if they do have to log in, it's usually the old gentleman or lady who doesn't want to use computers anymore and is forcing the young apprentice to log in and do all of the work. So we're breaking some of those age barriers down in the business. It's easy and it's definitely cost effective because you don't have to go through, like Daniel from Whirlpool was saying, write the business case, 100 pages, do that whole IS dance and then actually not deliver anything like maybe a Reba or something like that if you've ever had that experience. I really love what we've got. I've loved being here at this community. And I'm looking forward to sharing some further stories tonight. I encourage you to go and get some butter. Thanks. That one on the left-hand side there, that's back in the 1800s, 1880s, that's how we used to do butter. So things have come a long way, but it's still rectangular. And in terms of the journey, we've still got a long way to go, but thank you very much for having me, and I'll appreciate any questions, but cheers, and I'll talk to you over a beverage.